Hello friends, this video on NEET Electrostatics is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from... Question number 14. A parallel plate capacitor of area A, plate separation D and capacitance C is filled with 4 dielectric materials having dielectric constants K1, K2, K3 and K4 as shown in the figure below. So you can see here these 4 different colors that you see here, blue, orange, pink and yellow, they represent 4 dielectric materials with different dielectric constants. If a single dielectric material is to be used to have the same capacitance C in this capacitor, then its dielectric constant K is. So the question is trying to ask that let's say that instead of having 4 different dielectric materials, if you have to use one single dielectric material such that the net capacitance of that single dielectric material is the same as the net capacitance of all these 4 dielectric materials taken together, in that case, what should be the value of the dielectric constant for that dielectric material? So that is the question. So basically this means that let's say that we use a material, we use a single dielectric material such that it has the same capacitance C in this capacitor, right? That means the net capacitance of that single dielectric material will be C. And now in this scenario, when you have 4 different dielectric material, in that case also the net capacitance of this entire system is C. Right? So how do you calculate the net capacitance of this system of 4 dielectric materials? So basically if you look at this diagram in a just in a different way, so you would see that you can see that K1, K2 and K3 they are parallel to each other. That is not a series combination of capacitance, because if you see here it is like this. So this is K1, K2 and K3. And all of these are in a way like both ends of all the 3 capacitors are connected together. So therefore K1, K2 and K3, they are in parallel. So K1, K2, K3, they are in parallel combination. So therefore the net capacitance of K1, K2, K3 would be how much? Let's say that the capacitance for K1 is C1, for K2 it is C2, for K3 it is C3. So in that case the net series capacitance, let's call it as C dash, will be equal to C1 plus C2 plus C3, because when 3 capacitors are in parallel, then the net capacitance is the sum of the capacitance. Okay. Now let's talk about the equivalent capacitance of the system. Now this C dash and C4, they are in series, correct? Because this entire thing, if you see here, like these 3, they were in parallel, because you can see that the both the plates, like this plate of all the 3 are together. Like this plate was together. Similarly, this plate was together for all of them. So they were in parallel. But if you compare it with K4, in that case you see that their plates are not like, so let's say that their equivalent capacitance is C dash. So this is C dash and then here you have C4, C dash and C4. So here they're both the plates are not connected to the same point. So here they are connected end to end. So that means they are in series. So therefore 1 by C equivalent for this system will be equal to 1 by C dash plus 1 by C4. So this can be written as, now what is the equivalent capacitance of the system? It is C. So this is 1 by C is equal to 1 by C dash is C1 plus C2 plus C3 plus 1 by C4. Now we know that the capacitance for a parallel plate capacitor is A epsilon naught by D if the space between the 2 plates is filled with air. But in this case, we are talking about dielectrics with some dielectric constant. So this will be C is equal to Ka epsilon naught by D. So we will put this value of C in this expression. So this will be 1 by Ka epsilon naught by D is equal to 1 by C1. C1 will be K1. A by 3, because for C1 area is A by 3 and how much is D? D will be D by 2. So this is A by 3 into epsilon naught divided by d by 2. Similarly, plus, so in the denominator itself, it will be plus k2 a by 3 epsilon naught divided by d by 2 plus k3 a by 3 epsilon naught divided by d by 2. Now, plus 1 by c4. So, for c4, it will be a epsilon naught, because for c4, the area is a epsilon naught, okay, k4 into a epsilon naught divided by d, in this case again is d by 2. So, d by 2. So, now it is very simple mathematics. So, we get 1 by k a epsilon naught by d is equal to 1 by 2a divided by 3d epsilon naught k1 plus k2 plus k3 plus 1 by 2a epsilon naught by d into k4. So now if you compare left hand side and right hand side, what do you see? So epsilon naught, a, all these things will get cancelled. So this side also you have d in the denominator. So this d will also get cancelled. And therefore, what you will get? You will get 1 by k is equal to 1 by 2 by 3 k1 plus k2 plus k3 plus 1 by 2 k4. So now when you simplify this further, that means if you send this 2 to the numerator, so you get 2 by k, so 2 by k, so this 2 is not there, this becomes 3 by k1 plus k2 plus k3 plus 1 by k4, because this 2 is gone this side. So the correct expression is C. So see, it was not complicated as such, but you need to understand the question very well, because many a time students mistake, they feel that these are in series. So you have to understand that these are the plates of the capacitor, right? And if you see that one end, one plate for all the three capacitors are connected together, the other plate for all the three capacitors are again connected together, which shows that they are in parallel, right? So, in this fashion, you have to identify whether they are in series or parallel. Let's move on to the next question. Question number 15. A parallel plate air capacitor of capacitance C is connected to a cell of EMF V and then disconnected from it. A dielectric slab of dielectric constant K, which can just fill the air gap of the capacitor, is now inserted in it. Which of the following is incorrect? So here we have two situations. In the initial situation, we have, so what is the initial situation? We have air in the space between the plates of the capacitor. So in this case, well, how much is the charge stored? Charge stored is Q is equal to CV. How much is the potential difference? Obviously, potential difference is equal to charge per unit capacitance. And how much is the energy stored? So energy stored is equal to half CV square. So this is the initial situation when we have air between the plates of the capacitor. Now, in the second situation, we have a dielectric slab which has been inserted in the space between the plates. So what happens in this case? So now we have a new capacitance, right? So now the new capacitance will be equal to K times the old capacitance, correct? And as a result, now what will be the new potential difference? That will be equal to Q divided by C dash, that is the new capacitance, which is equal to Q divided by KC. And therefore, how much will be the new energy stored? That will be equal to half C dash V dash square. So this is equal to half into KC into Q square divided by K square C square. So this will get cancelled. So this is equal to Q square divided by 2KC. So these are the two situations, right? Now let us look at the options. First option says that the potential difference between the plates decreases K times. So if you see, the earlier potential difference was Q by C. Now the potential difference is 1 by K into Q by C. So obviously it has decreased K times. So this is correct. Second option, the energy stored in the capacitor decreases K times. So you see, initially the energy was half CV square. Now what is the energy? So now if you see, the energy is 1 upon k q square by 2c, because this cv square can also be written as q square by c, right? So that way is the nu energy also has reduced by k times. So this is also correct. The change in energy stored is half cv square 1 by k minus 1. So what will be the change in energy? So the change in energy is equal to E2 minus E1. Let us calculate. So this is equal to Q square divided by 2KC minus Q square, or let's say minus half CV square. Now Q square by 2KC. So instead of this, instead of writing it in terms of Q, we can also write it as half CV square by K minus half CV square. So this can be written as half CV square 1 by K minus 1. So this is also correct. Fourth one, the charge on the capacitor is not conserved. Now this is not correct, because the conservation of charge holds true even in this case. Because if you look at both the scenarios, charge is something which is still the same. It hasn't changed. So earlier it was C into V. Now charge is C dash into V dash. So the C has also changed. The V has also changed in such a way that their product still remains the same. So the charge on the capacitor remains conserved. So the incorrect point is option D. Question number 17. A spherical shell of radius 10 cm is carrying a charge Q. If the electric potential at distances 5 cm, 10 cm and 15 cm from the center of the spherical shell is V1, V2 and V3 respectively, then which of the following relation is correct? Now let us say that we are talking about a spherical shell of radius R. So when we talk about a spherical shell of radius R, it has been observed that the potential inside and the potential on the surface both are equal to KQ divided by R, where R is the radius. Now K is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Whereas when you want to find out the potential at a point outside the shell, then this is equal to KQ divided by R, where this R is the distance of that point from the center of the shell. Correct? So in this case, it has been given that the shell has a radius of 10 cm. Now, what are the points where we want to find out the potential? 5 cm, which is obviously a point inside, 10 cm, which is on the surface, 15 cm, which is outside. Right? So we can see that inside and on the surface, they are going to be the same. So V1 and V2, they are going to be equal. So obviously option B and option D, they are not the right options. Now, what about the outside point? So the outside point will be different. And also from this, we can see that the value of the potential is inversely proportional to R. Correct? So now, if you actually try to compare that on the surface, the value will be KQ by R. Whereas outside, it will be KQ by small r. Now, looking at this, you see that the value of capital R is 10 cm here. The value of small r is 15 cm here, because small r is the distance of the outside point from the center. So, we see that small r is greater than capital R. That means 1 by small r is less than 1 by capital R. Correct? So, that means this V surface is proportional to 1 by capital R. And V outside is proportional to 1 by small r. So we can say that V outside will be less than V surface. So therefore, V outside will be less than this value. So V3 will be less than V1 or V2, and V1 and V2 will be equal. So now if you compare these two, you would see that the correct option is A. Question number 18. An electron of mass Me initially at rest moves through a certain distance in uniform electric field in time t1. A proton of mass Mp also initially at rest takes time t2 to move through an equal distance in this uniform electric field. Neglecting the effect of gravity, the ratio t2 by t1 is nearly equal to. Okay, so let us try to solve this by using the equations of motion. So here the initial velocity is given as 0 because both of them are initially at rest. Now we know this equation, s is equal to ut plus half at square. So here this term becomes equal to 0 because u is 0. Now for the electron, the distance traveled will be equal to half ae te square. Right? Similarly for the proton, this will be half ap tp square. Now this in turn can be written as, how can we write the acceleration? Acceleration can be written as force by mass. So this can be written as Fe by Me into Te square. Similarly, this can be written as half Fp by Mp Tp square. We also know that force experienced by the electron is equal to force experienced by the proton. Why? Because force is equal to charge multiplied by electric field. And here it says that both of them travel in the same electric field. That means QE is same for both, therefore the force is same for both. So therefore, now you can divide these two equations. You can say that SE by SP will be equal to half FE by ME into TE square divided by half FP by MP TP square. So half half will cancel, FE FP will cancel. So this is equal to TE square divided by ME into MP divided by TP square. Right? Now here an interesting thing is that the question also tells that both of these electrons and proton, they travel through equal distance. That means SE and SP, they are same. So as per question, SE and SP are equal. So therefore, if these two are equal, so they cancel out. So you get 1 on the left hand side. So therefore, you can say that TE square by TP square is equal to ME by MP. Therefore, TE by TP is equal to root over ME by MP. And what is TE? So TE is basically T1. So T1 by T2 is equal to root over ME by MP. So therefore you can say T2 by T1 will be equal to root over MP by ME. So with this we get the final answer, which is option B. Question number 19. A conducting sphere of radius r is given a charge q. The electric potential and electric field at the center of the sphere respectively are. So we know that if we have a conducting sphere like this of radius r, then the potential on the surface and the potential at the center are the same. And the potential is given by kq by r. That is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by r. So that is the potential. And what about electric field? So if you talk about the electric field at the center, that is equal to 0. So the correct option is B. Question number 20. Two charges of equal magnitude q are placed in air at a distance 2a apart, and third charge minus q is placed at midpoint. Okay, so you basically have two charges like this, q placed like this, and exactly at the midpoint you have a charge minus q. The potential energy of the system is, so how do we calculate potential energy? Potential energy is equal to So the potential energy in this case, so I think
Thank you. Please visit examfear.com for free quality education. You can learn with a simple four-step learning process wherein you can watch video lessons, you can ask your questions, you can refer notes, and you can take a free online test. We have content for class 6 to 12 on physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology along with practical videos. So please subscribe to our channel for daily updates. Thank you.